phosphorus energy element, plant takes it in, and it's incorporated into a molecule called adenosine triphosphate. The energy is stored in the phosphate bonds, and then as the phosphate bonds are cleaved, it releases energy to do chemical reactions.
A lot of people, when there's overwatering, I'm always seeing a phosphorus deficiency with it. And then when we control the watering, it begins to fix itself. Have you noticed that, or any opinions or thought process around that?
And if you use a bloom stimulant, it actually turns on the genes, tell the plant, you know, stop making more stems and leaves, make more flowering parts. You definitely want to add extra potassium. If you got a 2% increase in yield, it would be statistically significant. Well, they added the biostimulant. Halfway through the trial, they were at 10% increase in yield and rising.
Have you ever wondered what the maximum nitrogen or calcium or magnesium or phosphorus you should put into your hydroponic system? Well, join us on a wonderful snippet with Harley Smith and make sure to check out the full video for over 2 hours of amazing content with Harley. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. Check us out on Instagram, Facebook, and make sure to hit the notifications for future updates. Let's go ahead and get into it. Make sure to check out our monthly membership. For as little as $2.99 a month, you get access now to 105 members, 2,586 photos, 274 videos, 21 files, 1,106 shared links, and much, much more.
Okay, let's move on. There's so many questions here. It says the numbers here are these in parentheses. They're not the targets. That's not what I'm trying to get when I formulate. This would, to me, is the highest I would want to go. I would never want to go above 250 parts per million nitrogen, even in veg. That's too much. You know, I'd really more like to see 220 is the most I would do during veg. And if I'm, and then I start ramping it down all the way to the end. So I'd rather be 180, 150, and be even 100 or less at the very, very, very end of harvest. Because I think that overdoing it with nitrates and phosphates, if you have free nitrogen in the sap that's not turning into organic molecules, I think that's what contributes to the off flavors. You know, and also if you don't cure properly and you get rid of some of that chlorophyll and the nitrogen in there, then you're not going to have the good flavors either. But if you overdo it with the nitrogen, you can get the bad flavors. And that a lot of times is attributed to the hydroponic grown nutrients. Because again, remember, in soil, it's very volatile with the nitrogen. So if we're giving a constant nitrogen, you know, that can take it up all the time, you can take up too much. You don't want free nitrates. You want a nitrogen conversion factor. All right, let's move on here. Nitrogen, growth element, we covered that enough. Nitrates and ammonium. Phosphorus is the energy element.
You can never cover it enough. You know, I am actually like really deeply engaged. Like I'm like critically listening. That's why I'm so quiet. I want you to know that, like really paying attention. So just know you cannot ever talk about it enough.
Okay.
Okay.
Phosphorus energy element, plant takes it in and it's incorporated into a molecule called adenosine triphosphate. That's the energy currency of the plant. The energy is stored in the phosphate bonds. And then as the phosphate bonds are cleaved, it releases energy to do chemical reactions. You know, so it's the energy element. Where phosphorus spoon feeding is the most beneficial, you need adequate phosphorus all the way through. You know, but early phosphorus stimulates earlier rooting. So if you had a starter fertilizer, typically they would add a little extra phosphorus in that fertilizer in the form of monoammonium phosphate, because the ammonium actually aids with the uptake of the phosphorus. So that's one place to use a little extra, and I mean little. You don't overdo it. The other time is early flowering. Phosphorus stimulates earlier flowering and more flowering sites. We mentioned that earlier. But to me, it's not just giving it a little bit of phosphorus, which is okay to do, but it's making sure you have a high Brix. You have a lot of sugar stored up in the sap so they can take up that phosphorus quickly. Phosphorus gets locked up in the soil very quickly. It locks up with calcium, makes calcium phosphate. That's what your bones are made out of. That's 95% water insoluble. If it's insoluble, it's unavailable to the plant. So the phosphorus in acidic soils, phosphorus locks up with iron, makes iron phosphate and precipitates out. So it gets locked up really, really easily in the plant, in the soil. So we just give it a, a little bit at the right time. And we tend, because of that, as an industry, and I don't know if what you guys think about this, but I'd ask your opinions. As an industry, I think that we're using too much phosphorus. I see it in my leaf analysis, see it in my sap analysis. I think it comes from the old days with agriculture, but you have to add 5 times more phosphorus than the plant needs because it locks up, becomes unavailable. So they want to get some to the plant, so they add too much. But when we're doing phosphorus and overdoing it with phosphorus in our plants, especially in hydro, then again, that will contribute to the off levers and the burning characteristics. It starts to burn like road flares.
I'd love to get your opinion on this around the phosphorus, because I think it also circles around their watering practice. Like they're over watering, which is flushing out the trace minerals, and the phosphorus is going right with it. And I think, and tell me if I'm wrong, again, this is my opinion. I think phosphorus needs a little more time to do its chemical reaction in the soil before uptaking, whether it is uptaking quick or not. I'm not sure around that. And when they're over watering, it just seems like when we go through a watering process where it's a bottom feed up, we just seem to have less issues, right? And then or when we do a watering where it's very little watering where it's coming out, we have less issues. It seems like we just in living soil. But when there's over watering, I'm always seeing a phosphorus deficiency with it. And then when we control the watering, it begins to fix itself. Have you noticed that, or any opinions or thought process around that?
Well, I haven't thought of it that way directly. You know, I know the overwatering definitely washes out nitrates very quickly. The phosphates are more locked up and unavailable. But my opinion is to get the phosphorus more available in living soil, again, it's the microbes. It's the mycorrhizal fungi, and it's the plant growth promoting rhizobacteria. There's some that are phosphorus solubilizing, and the good combination is the best, because as the mycorrhizae, as the mycelium is growing in the root zone, the mycorrhizae, it penetrates the roots, the root cells, and then it starts to grow. And as it's growing, the mycelium is growing, it's exuding organic acids and enzymes that unlock phosphorus from the soil, unlock phosphorus from the organic matter, and then literally feed it to the plant. Now, to help that, there's phosphorus solubilizing bacteria that'll hitch a ride on the mycorrhizae, and they'll go to places that they couldn't get to on their own because they're riding on the mycorrhizae. And then they swim in the soil solution in that area, unlock phosphorus, feed it to the mycorrhizae, and then the mycorrhizae feeds it to the plant. So there's phosphorus solubilizing bacteria on the surface of the roots that help make it available. There's also phosphorus solubilizing bacteria that work in conjunction with the mycorrhizae. So you can see that in nature, in organics, where you get the better, quote unquote, you don't get that off flavor. You know how many people talk about that? Oh, I really like the organically grown. It tastes better. Well, I think it's because of the phosphorus. In nature, phosphorus is so limiting that you'd have to have the limiting to the bacteria and fungi to make it available, and they're doing it real time, little at a time. Where in hydroponics, all the phosphorus is 100% available to the plant. So they're taking up way more phosphorus than they typically would in nature. And I think that is a potential problem in hydroponics. So I really like to, you know, I know that's important for flowering, but there's a limit. There's a point where they really don't need all that soluble phosphorus. And again, the sap analysis will tell me that. And even now, even though I've cut back my phosphorus at the end, I still think I'm using too much. I still haven't found. I want to do an experiment, and I will, with Fluence here one of these days soon. They want to set up a research facility with me, and I want to find out what is the lowest amount of phosphorus in hydroponics that we can use that has a beneficial effect without, you know, reducing quality or yield. I want to find the low end, not just keep pouring it on.
Less phosphorus, more microbiology to unlock it. So it's your thought process. Oh, that makes complete sense.
I love it. I love that idea. But I don't think it's because it's organic. I think it's because we tend to overdo phosphorus. That's what that's my opinion too. And I also I want to prove it though. So early flowering is where it's most important. Potassium, heavy flowering, like we talked about, weeks 4, 5, even 6. But then you just, if you do its analysis, then you'll know when too much is too much for heavy fruit and flower production. And if you use a bloom stimulant, it actually turns on the genes, tell the plant to make, stop, you know, stop making more leaves, stems and leaves, make more flowering parts. You definitely want to add extra potassium. I love this slide here. I wanted to make sure it was included. I was able to go to a research greenhouse in Belgium. That's my wife, Sue, there on the screen. Anyway, they were doing the first trials on bloom stimulants, organic bloom stimulants, that they were adding very, very small amounts. They were growing pepper plants, and they were 12 feet tall pepper plants, just loaded with fruit. According to the scientists, in those conditions, you know, plus or minus half a degree, perfect mineral balance, but they knew from these, from growing peppers commercially, this was, if you got a 2% increase in yield, it would be statistically significant. Well, they added the biostimulant. Halfway through the trial, they were at 10% increase in yield and rising. Not just the amount of fruit, but the how heavy they were. More flowers, more fruit, heavier, better quality fruit. Better calcium uptake, by the way. More shelf life. But I also got to see...
Was that by chance a fermented plant extract?
That was part of the recipe, absolutely.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about like oligosaccharides and stuff like that.
They were doing some plant extracts. They were pre-treating it with a protease. What was it? I actually saw it there when I wasn't supposed to, when I was in Amsterdam. A papayan.
It's an
enzyme from papayas. It's a protease that helps to break down proteins. I actually saw a bag of that. And what's that for? You're not supposed to see that. So they were pre-treating their organic matter with to break it down into some more amino acids. Then they shipped that product, end product, to India. And they were going...
Pain as well, yeah.
Yeah, so there was the plant mass that was pre-digested, sent it to India, and they went through a series of bioreactors with different microorganisms in it. And they took the very extracts at the end, at just a drop. I mean, I'm serious. And it was having this huge effect on the plants because there were some, you know, there are cofactors and coenzymes in there and things we don't even know. We don't even know what's going on.
It made a really sweet plant.
Yeah, but yeah, it worked. But that was halfway through the trial. I saw it with my own eyes. But here's the thing with potassium. I'll make sure I work this in, is I also saw the nutrient formulas they were using. And they were measuring the nutrients at the roots too, to see which nutrients were being taken down, which ones were building up. So as the plant was putting on more weight with flowers and fruit, the potassium was being run down faster than any other element. All the other elements, you know, pretty close, going down a little bit, but potassium was significant. So we know how important that is for the flowering process, for the carbohydrate metabolism. So I recommend if someone is using a true extract like that, a true biostimulant, that they add potassium with it. Because otherwise, potassium will quickly become the limiting factor. And I even asked him, I said, oh, won't potassium be the limiting factor? Why don't you add some potassium? He said, we can't do that. I said, well, why not? They said, because this is a controlled experiment. If we add the biostimulant and the potassium, someone can look at the results later and say, oh, it's because you added more potassium. It wasn't that organics. It was potassium. Yeah. So they had to do it that way. But I can tell my students too, add the potassium with it. And, oh, by the way, I was in there. Another thing. I went to, this was the research greenhouse. But I also went to some commercial pepper growers' greenhouses in Amsterdam where they're growing the top quality peppers, the best of the best, shipping them to the markets in New York City. Now, these were premium. You can see a picture. Here's one. You know? But I was taking pictures. Here's one of the pictures I took. And he said, why are you taking the picture of the plant? I said, well, you know, we don't see 12-foot tall pepper plants in the United States. You know, this is pretty impressive. He goes, you should be taking a picture of the bottom of the plant. What? And he showed me. Here it is down the corner. You can see that. See this sucker coming out the bottom? It has three sets of peppers on it.
Wow.
Because that's not normal.
I can't believe it's producing that much fruit down at the bottom. And it looks healthy. Holy crap.
Yeah, it should be just That's a vegetative shoot coming out of the bottom.
Get rid of trimming your bottom one third of your flowers.
So I'm just
joking.
I don't know about that. But.
I use a line that's out of Amsterdam. It's called Canna, and they have their own plant extract that they've been using for a long time, and they say to use it along with like a boost, not a PK boost, but like with extra potassium. And I've been noticing that at the bottom, so there's no more larf anymore. It's just like actual nugs at the bottom. So it's kind of crazy how that the difference that stuff makes, and what like whatever the components are all in there, it works.
Yeah, it does. And that's how I know it's working on my own plants at home. If I see at the very, very bottom of the plant, maybe a little branch, I didn't trim off, right there, growing, I'm like, oh yeah, that's the biostimulants. And part of the secret of that, the science, is it's called a zinc finger transcription factor. Four amino acids, four cysteine molecules, that's an amino acid with sulfur in it, attached to one zinc ion that goes into the cell, into the nucleus, attaches to the DNA in the plant and turns on a series of genes that tells the plant, don't make more stems and leaves, make flowering parts. So it's actually activating genes in the plant.
Like a key in a lock.
Yeah. So down at the bottom of the plant there, the genes would normally be saying, yeah, just make stems and leaves, make a shoot, a sucker. But it can't do it. It says, because the genes are turned on, they say, oh, well, let's make some fruit and flowers. Let's make flowers and fruit. So that's part of how
it works. Does that activate? Does that activate the plant's full genetic like capabilities, whether it be more the mother or the father of the like what's in the genes? It's able to reach its full potential to an extent.
Yeah, well, as a transcription factor is what turns on genes. The genes are there, but it turns it on. And of course, you want to. The idea is during flowering to turn them on and leave them on. So it's not really, those genes are either on or they're off. You know, you can't really, turn them more on. You can't say, well, I'll add more and I'll get more. No, if you turn them on and leave them on, it just takes a microscopic amount to do that. And then it's going to have the effect.
Is this a product available on, I mean, obviously from Canna, they have one, but the one you're discussing, is that available to the public or is it just for private use at this point?
Well, the raw ingredients, I got to experiment with them too, were just sold to manufacturers that would add it as an ingredient.
Got
and
it.
Sell it. Like probably what, you know, I think one of them that, what was that? Remember Bloombastic?
Is that absolutely. Was that in there too? I used to use that.
That ingredient was in there.
That's interesting.
It was in there. And there was another one called Because.
I remember that one.
While. Mm-hmm. That one had that ingredient in it. And the third one was the one that I was working with because we were importing it from the Netherlands and bottling it. And that was called Green Fuse. We had a Green Fuse bloom that had that in it. It was way diluted down.
But we can't guarantee it's still in there at this point, but that's interesting. It was, you knew it was in there that back in the day, at least 5-10 years ago.
Yeah, it's probably in more things now. I don't know because they don't really tell you much about it. I just know because I was meeting with the manufacturers of the product and when they took me to some greenhouses and into their research in that research facility to actually see the results scientifically proven.
Wow. You know?
When I'm looking at water analysis, I don't want to see more than 70 parts per million of chloride. That's kind of my limit. And no more than 50 parts per million of sodium.